Oh man, I love it. One of the weird things about talking with masks is you actually have to get closer to people because you're like talking like this, and then people are like, "Hey, what'd you say?" And I'm like, "I need to get closer." But love seeing you guys. I looked forward to today. We had the opportunity to go up north with Brandy's family, and so that was really fun. Drew rescued me and got me after my car broke down and took me to Honda. Didn't end up costing that much, so praise God. So thank you for your prayers, for real. I lovingly call my van Scar because I feel like it has a little bit of everything wrong with it. And there's a giant scar on the hood, so its name is Scar, and I love it when it works. And I'm sure you guys feel the same way about your vehicles, but just really glad to be here today. Beautiful, nice, sort of cool morning, finally. I think we needed that. I know my garden needed that. So I'm grateful that we have a little bit of natural air conditioning, and grateful that it looks like it's going to be a gorgeous day out. So let's go to God in prayer as we begin this service. Lord, we just come to you today grateful. We woke up. We woke up and got out of bed, and we drove in a car here, and there's AC going, and we should be thankful. And the biggest thing we should be thankful for is that we have a knowledge of someone who died for us and who saved us on the cross. And we just want to say, thank you, Lord, for our friends and our family and our freedom. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to be here today. Thank you that we have breath in our lungs, that we can praise you. And we just lift this morning up wherever we're at, whether in the church or up at our cabin or online or even in the middle of making ornery kids breakfast. Whatever we're doing, God, we just want to say thank you, Lord. Just lift this service up to you. Pray that we would worship you in our heart and our mind and our soul, and that when we leave here, we could be more like Jesus. We just lift this up in your precious name. Amen. We have been sort of entering into a weird time, into an interesting time where we try to worship God in spirit and truth without traditionally singing songs until the very end. And it's been weird, right? It has. But one of my friends reminded me that he spent some time at a monastery where everyone took a vow of silence. And I was like, man, sometimes doing church like this sort of feels like that, but wouldn't that be weird to come to service and not say anything? I'd be up here doing sign language, you know, and I was just thinking about, would sign language be allowed in a vow of silence? I don't know. Things that make you go, right? But the bottom line is, it's such a blessing that we can worship God no matter what we have going on. And I'm going to never forget this. When we went on a mission trip to Haiti, and we went into this really junky building, most of us would call it a barn that needs to be torn down. Only this barn was made out of cinder blocks. And we go there, and I go in, and there's the Haitian people are just worshiping God in a language I don't understand. There's dogs and chickens running in and out of the church, and there's a lot of noise. And it was one of the most interesting things I've ever experienced because we had a translator. And so this guy was speaking in Haitian, and by speaking, I mean yelling at the top of his lungs, preaching in Haitian, and then immediately, like 15 seconds after he got going, the American translator would start going, and it'd be like, and it'd be like, and then God said this, and you're like, your brain's like, oh my gosh, I don't know if I can handle this. But I'll never forget, when they did worship, they had, you know, what we would call garage sale items for instruments. They had cans, they had bottles, and what really mattered at the end of the day was they brought a spirit of love. And to this day, I think that's gonna be for a long time one of my favorite worship experiences because I didn't know what was being said, I didn't know what was being sung, but I felt the worship in my spirit because everybody was united on that. And so today, as we sort of enter into this couple weeks in of sort of having a weird service, just roll with it because God is bigger than this, okay? On that vein and that note, We're going to just enter into a time of personal prayer and worship. I think we all have been able to keep up with some of the things that Dick has been sending out on the email chain and all that kind of stuff. But right now, I just want to enter into a time of corporate worship. This is a time where you sort of just talk to God. It's really that simple. You can do it audibly or in your mind. Just make sure whatever's going on here and here is trying to focus on the Father, because sometimes you can be going here and your mind will be like, oh man, I gotta go get some food from Payless after church. I really need my ice cream or my night will be ruined. Oh, sorry, that's just me speaking out loud. But you know what I mean. Just try to have, during prayer, just try to keep things focused in the towards God. So we're going to start that right now. I'm going to play some quiet music, and I'll just direct you a little bit as to where to head, okay? The first place we're going to head is to pray for our nation. Lord, help us. Help us be a people that bring peace and that bring unity, even when we absolutely and vehemently disagree with the people around us about everything. God, help us be people that bring the love and light of Jesus. Lord, right now, let's each of us pray for our leaders, city leaders, church leaders, school leaders, teachers, coaches, presidents, congressmen and women. Let us pray for them now individually. Lord, I pray right now that we would just lift up our public officers, paramedics, doctors, nurses, firemen and women, police officers, military. Just want to lift up all the health needs, friends and family and people we may not even know right now that you know of. Obviously here in the church, we got multiple people to lift up. And if you don't know who that is, God knows, and just pray for them. But also everybody has people in their lives that need prayer. So right now, just personal family, friends, people that you know, let's just lift them up in prayer for healing and for God to make himself known to them. God, we come to you today just well aware of your presence and your power. Prayer is the bridge between our worlds, our spiritual realm and our earthly realm, through the blood of Jesus Christ. And when we get into these moments with God, it's amazing the emotion we feel, Lord. And I just pray that you would make yourself known to us during this service today, and that we could make your name known through the rest of the week. God, that we would be light in darkness, that we would be people who love first. God, and I just pray right now, and I just pray for Shirley. Lord, she's got another big test coming up, and God, you put her on my mind right this moment. I pray for Jill. Pray for everybody who's struggling. I pray for people who haven't been able to be here for a long time, God. The loneliness and the separation that can occur, God. And I just pray that you'd put a hedge of protection around everyone because of the way the relationships can dissolve, because it feels like there's disconnect, God. But you are bigger than that. And I just lift them up right now, Lord. I pray that we would be able and willing people to be ambassadors for Jesus. God, and I just lift this time up. I pray that we could be more like you. I pray that you would drop scales from our eyes, that you'd open our hearts and minds to your word and what you have to say, God. And we just lift this service up. Pray for healing for everyone in this room, and especially those that we prayed for, God, through the blood and the power of Jesus Christ. We lift this up in your precious, wonderful name. Amen. I feel weird having to say this, but I'm going to say it again. Just you can give online on PayPal, or when you leave, there's little white baskets if you have a tithe and offering. We would be very grateful if you guys would give that way. And I just want to say, please give yourselves a hand right now. I'm serious, because you guys have been very faithful during this time of uncertainty, and I am so proud of you. I'm proud to be your pastor, because I've talked to some of my friends, and financially we're doing okay right now. And there's a lot of people that aren't. So praise God. Thank you for being able to do that as you can. And remember, I always say time, talent, treasure. So you might not have the treasure right now, but you can have time and talent. And thanks for those of you that reached out last week and said you could be able to help around here with some random stuff. Appreciate it, because I'm a nerd and physical stuff is not my forte. If you want someone to build your house, if you call me, your house will look like a dog room or like a little kid's Lego building after they got smashed. So just thank you for that. So just remember, as you leave, you can give in the baskets. We're going to jump right in today. God, once again, in his hilarious sense of humor, decided to, shift my sermon a little this morning at 3 a.m. when I heard Raya running around the house. I don't know why she was up at 3, but when you have 5 kids, you start to factor in a percentage. One of them's usually up at some time during the night, and usually mama is the person who gets attacked by them. So, but I woke up 3, and then God and I started having discussion because I was trying to figure out what Raya was doing, so then I was up, and so, yeah, God changed this up on me. But remember last week, we talked about a couple things. Us, Christians who actively follow Jesus and engage in relationally with Jesus through prayer, reading his word, and dying to self through the power of the Holy Spirit. This is a better definition than Christians. Us doesn't equal Christians, not by my research, okay? Remember, us has purpose, has a mission, and has a king. So the title of this has been Us Versus Them. And today, we're actually going to address this issue of versus. I was probably 6, 7, 8, maybe Raya's age, when my dad got a tandem with a raised bracket. And so what that meant was my dad and I were able to ride on this tandem, and the back, so like a tandem's got your front pedals, and it's got your back pedals, so two people can ride. Well, what this was is it went front pedals for the adult, back pedals, a little add-on up the seat post, and then another set of pedals. So my dad got that for me when I was about 6, 7, or 8, and I actually got on TV twice because I was riding on the back with my dad, and it was sort of a new thing, and so people were really interested, and I was pretty spunky. I don't know where I got that from, but I did. And one thing about me was I looked at every other biker at that age as someone who could never pass us. So when we would ride organized ride, if someone would pass us, I would start pedaling, because I never pedaled unless someone passed us. My dad hated it. I'd put my feet up on the crossbar and cheat. My dad would look at our shadow and he'd be like, "You're not pedaling." And I'd be like, "Oh, sorry." And I'd start pedaling again. But whenever anybody passed us, I would put my feet into those pedals and I would pedal as fast as I could. And then so dad had to pass him because he couldn't stop me from pedaling. So dad, we would speed back up the person, and I'm sure my dad felt like obnoxious because these people would pass us and I'd start cranking as fast as I could and we'd go pass them back. And I'd be like, "Yeah." And then you'd do that a couple times, and my dad would finally just be like, "Stop. This person is faster than us because you only choose to pedal after they pass us. If you just pedal, they'd never pass us." And I'd be like, "But that's what I do." But the bottom line was, I sort of had this versus mentality. It was me versus them. My question to you is, do you have a versus mentality? It is highly fostered in our American society. We have this thing called competition. It's not a bad thing per se, but here's where it can get bad, is when we allow it to divide us. I'll give you a really good example. Democrats versus Republicans. Or how about this? Colts versus Patriots. Ooh, yeah, that one's got some salt and some wounds there. Or this one. Some of you can identify with this. Because I just feel like Notre Dame is against the world because they're not in a conference, so they don't really have their own rival, really. Honestly. Or this one. Brandy would appreciate this one. Michigan versus Ohio State. Yeah, or this, dog person versus cat person. If you're a cat person, I'll pray for you. Or how about this one? Pineapple on pizza versus I am normal, stop. The bottom line is, we really do live in a society of verses. I mean, I could have gone on forever. Chevy versus Ford, blah, 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 PlayStation versus Xbox. I could have gone on forever. Apple versus PC. I mean, we have this like division amongst us. We just sort of say, well, we lump people. As soon as we figure out that they are not a fan of Notre Dame, for example, sorry, you're not as cool. You're not on my level. You know what I mean? And it's this thing. It's this versus society, and it can be extremely divisive if we allow it to. Remember what I talked about last week about idols, sort of having a higher priority than God? This is definitely one of those things. I know some people, I love them dearly, who have a hard time deciding between the Cubs and God. And you laugh, but I'm dead serious. They are so close to idolization of the Cubs that I'm like, oh my gosh, wait, you spent how much to buy a seat from the old stadium? Oh my goodness, Lord, have mercy. I'm not being rude. I'm not being judgmental. I'm just saying we have to check ourselves, because in a versus society, what happens when you walk into the division realm, all of a sudden that divisiveness can create an idol because it becomes a competition. And where I am a normally good-hearted person, when I get competitive, I am not. In fact, Brandy's best friend tried to play a board game with me one time, and she ended up crying. True story. We've never played a board game with her since, because I'm competitive. And something weird rises up in me, and I will be a jerk if it means I can win. But isn't that what we're sort of taught? The second place is first place losers? We work hard, and I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I'm just saying in a versus society, we have to understand when I say us versus them, that maybe this isn't the best word. Mark 33, 24 through 25 says this, "If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. If a house is divided against itself, that house cannot stand." Does the church have a problem with division? Yup. Here's one. Hymns versus non-hymns. Because that causes a lot of division. People want what they like to be played in their church. I get it. It's the truth. But here's the problem. If we care more about our music style than loving our neighbors, then who cares what we sing or in what style? Because nobody's going to come to that church. People aren't going to come to a church just because they heard the music was great. People are going to come to the church because Jesus is alive in us and we are exhibiting fruit of the Spirit and the light is shining out of our lives into the darkness that is existing in theirs. At the bottom line is this, in this situation, in every situation, it becomes flesh versus spirit. It becomes me versus God. And when we allow me to win, we allow God to lose. That's the point of idolization. That's the point of division. That's the point of this versus. Ephesians, at home, we're going to be out of Ephesians 4, starting in verse 10. So if you guys want to get there here, you don't have anything to look at, but if you got a phone that you've been touching and no one else has been touching, please open that up. Ephesians 4, verse 10, it says this, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take stand against the devil's schemes." So, question is, why are we putting on the full armor of God? So that what? We're putting on the armor of God so that when we walk into this world as followers of Jesus, we don't fall for the tricks, the interpretations, the divisiveness of the enemy, the devil. That's why we're doing it. It says right there, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms." How many of you guys have ever had an addiction? Good or bad, I don't care. It can be dessert, it can be food, it can be bad stuff that people, but honestly, an addiction is the same. What addiction is, it's power over your mind. Seriously. And I got to tell you, I don't care who you are, if you've had one and that's your weakness, you're going to be in the middle of like the weirdest thing, have not even had a struggle or an issue for years, and all of a sudden, boom! Out of the blue, the thought comes into your mind. Where did that thought come from? We live in a reality where we diminish the spiritual and elevate the physical. But as believers, we have to recognize both realms. Because we have a heavenly Father that came from the heavenly realm and became physical on earth as a human. And we got to believe in both. This isn't a one or the other. We have to understand there are forces that operate to destroy us, as the Bible says, to devour us like a roaring lion, so that we can't live life to the fullest the way God created us to do. So it says, continuing on, "Because of that reason, therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything to stand, stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helm of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. It's a flesh versus God battle. It's a me versus God battle. It's a flesh versus spirit battle. It's a me versus God battle. It's verse. We are against the enemy. Okay? That is the reality. And so when I say us versus them, maybe versus, because it's sort of a negative connotation, I think just societally, maybe versus is absolutely the wrong way to look at this. It fits societally, but not biblically. Maybe it should be this: us for them. Us being Jesus followers for them being non-followers. One of the saddest stats that I read is that we tend to bubbleize our lives. Once you become a follower of Jesus, you tend to get rid of old friendships and get rid of people who maybe annoy you because they don't have the truth of the, of God. And the Bible, we start to be refined and God starts to take us down a new pathway. And so some of our old friendships just go away. And we're okay with it because they do bad stuff. They're sinners. They're walking down a different path. Now, my challenge to you is this. That is 190% absolutely unbiblical unless you are getting rid of that relationship so that you can be strong enough to go back and not be tempted. Okay? There's a time where relationships have to shift and change, where someone's doing, say marijuana, say alcohol. Someone's smoking weed, they think it's okay, and you want to get out of that lifestyle and you need to get away, so you leave that relationship until you can get strong enough. Well, there's a way to be intentional to create a space that you're still in relationship with that person, but not allowing the temptation to be the main thing. So instead of meeting at their house, you go out to eat. You meet at wherever. You do this. But the bottom line is, as Christians, we are commanded and called to be for them, to be for people. Remember this. Us, our purpose and mission comes from God, our King. Remember Matthew 28? I've been saying this so much. All authority on heaven and earth has been given to me. Therefore, go. He doesn't say, hey, Sunday during that hour period when you serve me and you come and you worship me, yeah, during that hour period on Sunday, if you feel like it, could you possibly pray a little more? That'd be great. Thanks. Here's a Hershey kiss and a cookie. No, see, God here, He comes to us as a King and He says, hey, all authority on heaven and earth is mine. Here's what I want you to do. I'm about to go back to where I'm from. So that's why I say our purpose and mission comes from God, our King. But the question then becomes, who is God for? Because we got to be for people who don't know God. Well, who is God for? Well, I'm glad you asked. Get ready, okay? We're going to go from Genesis to Revelation. Are you ready for this? I'm going to go decently quick. You're not going to be able to follow me online, but I will post a link to all these scriptures I'm about to say. Because I want you to understand that God's heart and who God is for has been very evident from the beginning. From the very beginning, God has been for more people than He's ever been against. Genesis 12, 1 through 3. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land I will show you, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse. And in you, all the families of earth will be blessed. Okay, if you're part of all the families of earth, please raise your hand. Uh-oh, Somebody's not listening. I'm just messing. Now we're moving into Exodus. Exodus 9, 15 through 16. Remember, some things happened in Exodus in Egypt. Really big deals. Okay, so check this out. Verse 15. For by now I could have put out my hand and struck you and your people with pestilence, and you would have been cut off from the earth. But for this purpose I have raised you up, to show you my power, so that my name may be proclaimed in all the earth. Then David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with a sword and spear and with a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. And I will give the dead bodies of the host of the Philistines, and I will give the dead bodies of the host of the Philistines this day to the birds of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know there is a God in Israel." That's the why that the 13-year-old David took down a giant UFC fighting, amazing gladiator that all the men were afraid to fight, because he defied the name of God. And David says that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. Psalms 46:10 says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth." In Isaiah 49:6, he says, "It is too light a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and bring back the preserved of Israel. I will make you as a light for the nations, that my salvation may reach to the ends of the earth." In Ezekiel 37:27, "My dwelling place shall be with them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people." Malachi 1:11, "My name will be great among the nations, from where the sun rises to where it sets. In every place, incense and pure offerings will be brought to me, because my name will be great among the nations, says the Lord Almighty." And we're now just getting to the New Testament. Mark 16:15, "And he said to them, 'Go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation.'" If you're part of whole creation, raise your hand. I see you at home not raising your hand. You better raise your hand, because I can see you. That is the power of technology. I am kidding. I cannot see you. Don't be freaked out. Nice pajamas. "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." Acts 1:8. Romans 15:20 through 21, "I make it my ambition to preach the gospel, not where Christ has been named, lest I build on someone else's foundation, but as it is written, those who have never been told of him will see, and those who have never heard will understand." 1 John 2:2, "He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours, but also for the sins of the whole world." And they sang a new song, Revelation 5:9, saying, "Worthy are you to take the scroll and open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation." Revelation 7:9-10, "And after this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, 'Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb.'" So my question is this: who is God for? Nations, peoples, ethnies. He's for the world, all of creation, the ends of the earth. Remember John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him would not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world," to say, "Hey, go to hell." He sent his Son into the world to save them. That's his heart. And it's been his heart from Genesis 12 on, from the beginning. He wanted that relationship that was designed for us to be with God in the garden. He wanted us back, and he was willing to do whatever it took, including sending his one and only Son to earth to suffer a death he didn't deserve. And when we walk into people's lives, we have to know that we are doing the will of God. Is it going to be easy or fun? No, it's probably going to stink sometimes because we can hardly get along with our family. We can hardly get along in our church family. So if you expect it to be roses and peaches when you go out with people who don't know Jesus, that's sort of comical. It's going to be hard. But that's why we love them with the love of the Father and not with our own love. Because if we depend on my love, then our love's going to be like, whoop, yep, sorry, book is closed on this one. Disconnected, I'm sorry, I lost your call and I don't know your number anymore. Oh no, blocked, contactless, oh, ghosted, not answering calls, I'm done, I need a break, you've worn me out, I'm tired of you, I don't want to listen to this, I'm not fixing your problems, you need to go to someone else. Yeah, those kind of attitudes come from the flesh, not from God, because God never, ever will give up on us. Is it okay to take a break? Huh, yeah, you're human. Is it okay to be as innocent as doves and as shrewd as serpents? Yeah, the Bible says that. Is it okay to give up on people? No, because God won't give up on you. Is it easy to? 100%. It's easy to hang out with people who act the way we do, who speak the way we do, who don't do stupid things, and it's hard to hang around people who are stupid. Let's just be real. Why'd you do that? I don't know. Why'd you do that the fourth time? I don't know. I love you, but I want to punch you in the name of Jesus. You laugh because you thought it. But the bottom line is this. We got to remember, our mission from God is to be for people, nations, neighbors, not just on Sunday, but every day. You see, this series is now going to be called Us For Them. Us For Them. Roland Allen says this, missionary zeal does not grow out of intellectual beliefs nor out of theological arguments, but out of love. Because I can tell you, you can write a paper about how you're going to love somebody. You can read a book about how to build a house. But until you get in the trenches and God teaches you how selfish you are, it's at the end of yourself that you're going to be able to love people the way Jesus wants you to. Remember, those who seek their life will not find it. You know, those who lose their life will find it. Jesus says that. And what he means is, loving people out of such a deep capacity of love that everyone around you is like, you're stupid. Like, why do you let them walk over you? Why do you go back and take that? That's dumb. Yeah, it is dumb to the world. But to God, it's what he put you in that moment for. That's why you got to be in the Word. That's why you got to be in prayer to have the discernment to know when to say yes and when to say no. Does God want people to walk over you, take advantage of you? No. Does God want you to love people beyond the end of yourself? Yeah. Is there sometimes this weird crossover that happens at the same time? 100%. I've had a lot of drives where I'm mad at God the whole time. And I get there, and I love the person, I drop them off, and I'm still mad at God. I had plans. My life is important. Man, I was going to eat that bowl of ice cream tonight, and you messed it up. My rhythm's off. You know what time it is? I'm tired. I have to mow the lawn. I have to do this. But it's the 4 day later text. It's the conversation of, hey, I want to go to church this Sunday, without you having to ask the person. Because you're actually living the love of Jesus Christ. They don't know about how mad you were. They don't know about the struggle. But God knows. And that's why as Christians, as believers, we store up our treasures in heaven. Is it going to be scary to love people the way Jesus does? Absolutely. It is scary as all get out. And that's why I brought you these special verses. 2 Kings 6. I can't see that. 2 Kings 6:16. Do not be afraid, Elisha answered, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them. Yeah, believe it. And then Romans 8:31. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? Our mission from God is to be for peoples, nations, neighbors, not just on Sunday, but every day. And that is what it means to be a follower of Jesus. Is it hard? Yeah. Is it easy? No. Is it worth it? 100%. Because you get to be part of one of the most cosmic, cool journeys to see God literally use you, an imperfect person, to do something that lasts forever. Remember on Father's Day, we talked about legacies? Man, what a legacy to bring one person to know Jesus. Because that can affect their whole family. What a legacy to get yourself out of the way and bring two people to know Jesus. That can impact generations. Because that's how cool God is. What an amazing opportunity we have when we can just completely say the most stupid and wrong things, and God still uses us in spite of our failures, in spite of our faults. I didn't want to come preach today. I'm dead serious. I was tired. I was sort of ornery. Raya woke me up at 3 a.m. Love you. But I was just like, I don't want to go preach today. But you know what I did? I got back into my own preaching. I got back into my own scripture. And I said, you know what? I'm going to do this out of the Spirit today. Because my flesh is weak, my flesh is tired, but out of God's Spirit, I'm going to walk to that church, and I'm going to do my thing, because God is with me. And if God is with me, who can be against me, right? Can I get an amen? So today, as we close, I have a song that maybe you have heard, but I want this to be sort of the two-word anthem after leaving here today. Don't just hear this sermon. Don't just hear this sermon and do nothing. Okay? Just I think that song speaks for itself. Church, if we really want to be followers of Jesus, there are a lot of things we can do without doing anything. But at the end of the day, the more that you put Jesus as the center of your life, the more that you are going to be compelled to love. And so my challenge to you is do something. Doesn't have to be magical. Doesn't have to be incredibly special. It just needs to be rooted in that core of Jesus. I know Steve did something one time, stepped out and talked to somebody and was a blessing to their life. I know of little stories of people like Helen going and visiting and calling people when they probably could have had better things to do. And I know Phyllis has blessed me many times by taking care of my kids, and it doesn't seem like a whole lot. I got blessed yesterday when I got to go fishing with this man right here, and we didn't catch a whole lot, and I don't know if that was a blessing or not a blessing. But the bottom line is, do something. Because I'll give you a perfect example. Last night, there was a car broke down out of my house. Like, so my house is here, and there's a drive. Like, you could drive right into my driveway, and then it tees. And there was a Jeep broken down right there, and I saw him. But I was just like, there's a guy out there, and I was like, I probably got it taken care of. Well, Brandy is like, I'm going to go. I was being selfish. I'm gonna own it right now. I was being selfish, and I was just like, I'm not going out there because I don't want to. Like, straight up. Like I told you, I was in sort of a funk last night, later in the night, and I was just like, I'm not going out there. So Brandy goes out there, and oh boy, that ticked me off because I was like, you know, in my mind, I'm like, someone should do something, but I didn't want my wife to do it because see what happens when your wife does something as the husband, two shall become one, you're going to get involved. So of course, what then happens? I get involved because Brandy goes out there to offer our little jumper box because our Scar likes to not start once in a while, like every 4 days. So we had a fully charged jumper box, and Brandy goes out there and offers it. And the guy's like, no, we just live around the corner. We're going to try to push the car. So yeah, so Brandy comes in the house and it's like, they're going to try to push their car right around the block. And I'm like, okay. And she just looks at me. She looks at me like that. Facebook like that. And it was over. So what do? I go out there, I say, hello. And I open up the passenger door and grab right up here at the I'm a bad driver handle. And I start pushing that car down the street. Boy, was I excited. I'll tell you what. So the funniest thing about this, I mean, this is just the way God works. You know, bless my wife. I didn't want to do this, guys. I'm 100% being real. So we get like down the block and turn a corner. Well, there's a small hill. We all die. Just a small hill. We all die. And there's sort of awkwardly in the road and the car has to go by us. Well, there's this guy that is over here at this house. I felt like God wanted me to talk to him before, but I've never taken the initiative. So he's always outside smoking a cigarette. And I see him every time I go home. And about 2 weeks ago, right before vacation, you know, I felt like God, yeah, you should go say something to this guy. Well, guess who comes walking up? The guy who God told me I should say something to. And it's just like, are you serious? So he comes walking up, are you guys out of gas? He's like, no. And so he's like, oh, it's a Jeep Liberty and it's got the tire. So he goes and gets his truck. It's a F-150 Harley Davidson edition. I know that because I like that model of truck. And he brings it and he pushes his bumper right on the rear tire, spare tire of that car, and then push it all the way to the house. Well, guess who gives me a ride home to my house? John, my neighbor. And that is exactly why we need to do something. Because even when we don't want to, there's going to be lots of times where God's going to make us do it anyways. So you might as well get the blessing of being obedient the first time rather than having your wife call you up and out to do God's will. So just take action. Don't be like me and being bad. Because if I would have just walked out there in the first place, I would have probably been home 15 minutes earlier. True story. But just do something. So I'm going to end with a word of prayer, and then you guys are free to go. Remember, try not to remain in here. Try to walk out of this room, okay? God, we just thank you so much for this day. We thank you for taking action. We thank you for divine opportunities for us to get to know people and love them the way Jesus wants us to. And we lift up all of our inaction and all of our disobedience and selfishness, and we just ask, God, that you would help us be better at doing your will when you ask us and not until we feel comfortable. God, we just lift this day up and pray that we could be a light and a blessing to many. In your name, amen. God bless you guys. Have a great day.